Hi, Peter.
Hey, John.
It's great to see you. Welcome to marketing.
I don't get too much time to spend in marketing.
Yeah, I know. Engineers typically aren't allowed really into the marketing area. This is kind of a black hole, but we really appreciate you coming down so we can learn about some of the new things that are happening, actually, in engineering. What have we got here? It looks like these are like gold, silver, anodized.
Sure. The whole display here has to do with our power brick family of heat sinks. So they're specifically designed to be used on DC to DC type power bricks.
That's cool.
ATS has really put together a nice portfolio where we're able to fit these to the specific industry standard shapes. So in this case here, we're looking at a half brick DC to DC.
That's what these are, half bricks?
Half brick size.
Now, why would you use a half brick DC-DC converter versus, say, another kind of power supply or another power source? Is it something about the size of it, or just...
Sure. Well, in the DC-DC world, there's a lot of standard footprints, which allows for flexibility amongst different vendor selections or vendor choices. So there's some standards, quarter brick, eighth brick, half brick, full brick sizes, which may be scaled based on power, could be scaled based on feature set, could be scaled based on technology advancements. So they tend to fall into standard footprints, which allows for interoperability and ease of PCB layout, and also selection. And so what we've been able to do here in engineering is accommodate that by coming up with standard heatsink patterns that easy to address those specific heatsinks.
Okay, that sounds good. And so basically any kind of quarter power industry standard brick heatsink, power supply, but actually these heatsinks would probably fit on top of one.
Sure, it's an industry standard footprint, and the products have been designed to facilitate use with those products.
Now, is there anything special about these heatsinks? I mean, it looks like they have the standard kind of fin pattern, I guess?
Well, actually, here at ATS, we have a patented MaxiFlow technology, and what you see here is sort of an example of that, which is the splayed fin technology. And in doing that, we allow ourselves a couple of feature benefits, one of which is lower pressure drop. So we really allow the air to move without interruption and without pressure across the fins, which gives us better convection properties. So in fact, in independent third-party testing, we found a 40% increase in thermal conductivity.
Wow, that's amazing. And does the fin pattern also actually tend to kind of reduce air egress? Like, it looks like it would probably keep it kind of lower to the...
Sure. By allowing the air to flow through unimpeded, if you will, and having that lower pressure, it allows the air really to sit low along the fins and really get good airflow across that surface area. And with displayed fins, we're able to get more surface area, so the combination of those really impacts our performance and allows us to outperform straight fin, which is more common that you might find in the industry.
Now, is this the only kind of heatsink somebody would use? Like, say I'm a design engineer, so I design a couple of these on my board. Would these be the only kinds of heatsinks I could use this kind of pattern? Or
No. The short answer is no.
Okay.
It's interesting having a long background in power electronics. Actually, I like to think I spent a lot of years creating the problems, and now at ATS get the opportunity to help solve them. Thermal management really is more complex than any simple heatsink. So in this case, we've really facilitated it for the engineer to be able to select use with the DC to DC converter, but there could be different challenges in the environment that would suggest a different solution. In some cases, maybe the power is such that no heatsink's required. And other solutions, a more complex or intricate solution may be required, which may also incorporate outside ambient, incorporate overall profile and footprint and how much height you have to work with, as well as looking at some of the conduction paths that may be there, or the system level airflow that may be there that we can take advantage of. So really, it's good to work with the engineers and work with other companies and thermal engineers that can really help identify what the issues may be so they can provide the best solution. Another sort of quick thing here is, you know, we've got a thermal interface material here.
Okay.
In this case, this happens to be a phase change material. But that thermal interface is another impedance path. And so the selection of that, along with the attachment mechanism, really can influence the overall performance. So it's helpful, again, to understand what's the optimum, what's the best fit. And really, at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is manage to the design. And each design can be different. What's interesting about the DC to DC heatsinks is typically they're rated to have a maximum base plate temperature. So quite often it's 100 degrees C. So in that case, you know, we've got 100 degrees C as kind of our governing limit.
Okay. Yeah.
We also may be inside of that based on MTBF or safe operating area, but we've got a fixed point that we're trying to manage. So utilization of a heat sink allows us to help manage that base plate temperature. And if we can keep it to 100 degrees C, then we can really push that and drive that DC to DC converter. And in many cases, you know, optimum thermal management allows us to make sure we're not over-designing on the electronic
right.
side.
So cost more as a result of that. Probably.
Yeah, so we can cost optimize the electronics performance by incorporating proper thermal management. And that's really, really a key point in the value proposition of good thermal management within a system.
That's excellent. Now, are there any other kinds of things that you might want to consider, like an engineer would consider when they're kind of designing in a heat sink like this, or designing a thermal solution actually in general? I mean, the power bricks are pretty cool, and it looks like they're anodized as well.
Yeah, so the anodization actually is more than sort of for good looks. It actually provides better emissivity, so it allows it to radiate better, and that performs, that gives it better performance. For electrical engineers, the way I often describe it is it's a resistor network. It's a thermal impedance network. So we're managing the power dissipation that comes to the board. And as you can see here from a typical brick, the electrical engineers have done a good job of making sure that the power dissipating components are getting to that spreading platform. And then it's our job to get it into the atmosphere at an appropriate rate. So that thermal impedance network, if we think of it like any impedance network, you know, we've got a resistor to the base plate, we've got a resistor through this thermal interface material, our tin,
yeah.
that we mentioned earlier, and then we've got a resistance of the spreading of that power dissipation and that heat, and then we've got the resistance as it gets into convection and gets into the air. So trying to minimize those resistors is, you know, quite often the optimum way to come up with the best solution.
Wow.
What works against us is nature laws, cost effectiveness, marketing targets, etc. So we may have height profile limitations, or we may have board level limitations, or outside ambient or internal ambient, which can be different. And so we've got to work with all those different parameters to come up with the best solution. And, you know, we want to drive the best solution the first time, so we try to do our analytical computations up front to make sure that we're accommodating that power dissipation to meet the needs.
So you mentioned analytical work. So that sounds like something that's important. It was doing an analytical analysis before you actually do CFD or before you jump into the prototype space.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, CFD and computational tools are so powerful today. Mm-hmm. I mean, they provide a great ability to help iterate. But we always want to make sure that those iterations are based on a sort of independent, substantiated model, and we use analytical calculations to help us analyze that and make sure our model is built correctly with the right parameters and the right guarding factors to go into that. And then ultimately, empirical testing in the lab is the final say of
right.
how the product's going to perform. Have we accommodated the true power? Have we accommodated the true obstructions that may be there from an airflow point of view,
right.
for example? So really, the utilization of all three of those is equally important and helps drive to a best solution for the application.
That's great. Thank you very much. This has been really great. And power brick heat sinks are available from Advanced Thermal Solutions, qats.com. Just you can also send us email at ats-hq@qats.com.